thank you, Locust Projects and Art Center South Florida and the Cultural Center for having me. I'm going to look this way as I move images. I'm definitely no rock star, but I am a hardworking curator, and I could be a stunt double for a couple people, possibly, but I'll leave it at that. We're having some difficulty, so yeah, Michelle's helping me out up there. Thank you so much, Michelle. Really appreciate it. This is a picture I shot in Kanazawa, Japan, many years ago, at Leandro Ehrlich, his pool, where it makes the illusion of you being underwater. I just like it as an opening image. But what I wanted to start with is actually where I began this journey for me and how I got into this field in the first place, and it really came through music. And so this is just a little tiny sampling of music that I was listening to in college, early 90s, from sort of, you know, 88 to 93 ballpark. And it gives you a sense of really what has inspired me and moved me. More than anything, music has been my guide. With half the shows I've done, I've created a playlist or a soundscape or a soundtrack, including Prospect. And the other thing about it is that most of these artists were revolutionary in some way, shape, or form, either in their politics or their music, and groundbreaking. Even a band that probably most of you don't know, like Archers of Loaf, it was at that moment where indie rock was coming to the fore in the early 90s. And just the idea that you could do it yourself, that you didn't need a corporate label, you didn't need that kind of support, you just go out and do it. And that was very inspirational for me. The second thing that deeply impacted me, other than, of course, my parents, which I could talk about ad nauseum because they're the greatest influence in my life, it was the trip to Nigeria, spending a summer in Nigeria in college and living with very close family friends who I'd known for many years in the U.S. and North Carolina. But that time, and you'll see how it's translated into the work that I've done since then, I wound up going to graduate school and studying contemporary African art in a time when no one was teaching it yet in the United States. So again, just the idea that you can forge your own path, and that became a path, the road less traveled is where I'm most comfortable. In graduate school at the University of Michigan, I focused on contemporary African. No one was teaching it yet, so I taught and studied traditional African. I studied African-American art. I studied general contemporary art, and then I studied actually a lot of film as well. And but these were the two images that stuck with me out of everything in grad school, and it's the work, of course, of Barclay Hendrix. So these two images, if you can imagine, of course, for the younger folks in the room, there's the internet was just coming into existence in 94, 95. It almost practically didn't exist. And every image that you saw, you either had to see a real work of art in a museum or in a private collection or in a book. And these two images are what stuck with me. So I have to thank Rick Powell and Thelma Golden. So Thelma Golden's Black Male show in 94 and Rick Powell's survey of African-American art in 97. Now that image on the left of Barclay Hendrix, I just want to point out, is what was like seared into my memory. And not just because it's this nude portrait, self-portrait of Barclay, but his sense of humor, not just the beauty in which he captured the form and the classical stance, the contrapposto, but his sense of humor. So the title, Brilliantly Endowed, comes from obviously it's a double entendre here, and it comes from a quote by Hilton Kramer that was describing one of Barclay's shows and said Barclay is a brilliantly endowed painter. Barclay immediately went out and painted this self-portrait and called it Brilliantly Endowed. So that led to me leaving grad school, moving to New York. The first show I really got to curate was at Sycama, is then Brent Sycama, not Sycama Jenkins yet. I worked the front desk with Michael Jenkins. So it was the two of us and Brent, essentially, in the gallery. And they let me curate a summer show because at that time, there really weren't these curated summer shows. Is the norm now, and they're not just summer shows now, but people curate shows in galleries all the time. It used to be that most of the galleries would put up a selection of works by artists who they represented, and then they'd leave town for the summer and vacation. So they thought I could do no harm, and for me, it was a real opportunity. I knew I wanted to curate, and the first job I got was in this gallery, or the second job. And I wanted to reach out to Barclay Hendricks, and I didn't know him. And so I called up the Studio Museum, because the only work that I'd seen in person was at the Studio Museum, Lottie Mama. And I called up a curator there who I'd gotten to know, and I said, could you please pass along Barclay Hendricks' contact information? I want to reach out to him about the potential of showing his work. And the person on the other line said, very sheepishly, I will give you his information as long as you promise not to tell me it was me who gave it to you. Because Barclay had a reputation of being very prickly. And so I called him up, and I wondered what was going to happen. I didn't know if he would give me any time, if he would be annoyed that someone called him out of the blue, some young guy had never curated anything in his life, and what might transpire on the phone. What took place is Barclay actually picked up the phone, said, hello, who is this? I explained myself, why I was calling. I said, I'm organizing a summer show. I'd love to include your work. His sort of first question was, how do you know my work? Because it was very hard to see Barclay's work at that time. Unless you're at the Studio Museum in Harlem or the Philadelphia Museum of Art, the work was essentially not on view. And I explained in these books that I just showed you, and we talked for 2 hours. He was incredibly gracious and warm, and he said, why don't you come out to the house next weekend? And I took the train out, and you'll see that was the beginning of my career and my work in collaboration with Barclay Hendricks, and I just wanted to start off this way because we sort of... He already had an amazing career, and he helped give birth to the beginning of mine. So I just want to point out the other artists. If I can go back one, I'm sorry. Excuse me. The guns there are by Roberta Vizzani, New York-based artist originally from the Dakotas. The sculptural guns, and then if we go to the next slide... on the far right is Wageshi Mutu. She started in sculpture and installation. And I had met her shortly before this. This is 2000. I met her in maybe late 99, same time I met Barclay. And then on the left, Rena Banerjee installation and Tim Evans. Token white guy in the show. Tony Gray also had wonderful work in the show. And he still is a really underrated artist who's teaching at Nightingale in the Upper East Side. From there, this is where Lagos came in, and specifically Nigeria, because I actually spent most of my time in Ile Ife and not Lagos. But I had this crazy idea. I'd fallen in love with Fela's music. I'd known it already for 10 years or more. And when I was in Nigeria, I listened to it incessantly. The family that I lived with, the close friends, was a political scientist who had all of Fela's music and set me up in a bedroom, and I had a turntable in there, and I listened to it on vinyl seemingly all day, every day. And I got to organize this show called Black President in 2003, which opened at the New Museum of Contemporary Art. Now, I got to organize it by sheer persistence and dedication. I had no idea how to pitch a show to a museum. I didn't have any contacts in the art world. And the only thing I knew how to do was sort of reach out to artists and ask them about their interest in Fela. For those of you who don't know Fela, if we go to the next slide, Fela was the originator of Afrobeat music. He was the founder of that genre of music. He was a political gadfly, a dissident. He was a utopian visionary, in a very complex, complicated, and contradictory figure in many ways, but a real visionary and a hero to many. He also, most importantly, was a champion of those who were voiceless and who didn't have a champion for them. And he stood up to dictatorships time and time again, despite the harassment, despite the fact that he had his skull fractured, bones broken, and worse things even happened to other members of his family. But all that said, he was a very inspirational figure for me, and I kept thinking about this show. And the one thing I knew how to do was reach out to artists, and I kept hearing from them. The average person in the U.S. didn't know who Fela was at the time because he'd had very little exposure in the United States. And it turned out that artists, as I'd imagined, having sort of been focusing on contemporary African, were deeply inspired by him. And so I kept finding these artists who saying, yeah, I'd love to do something around this. Barclay being one of those people, because in 1977 he was in Lagos for Festac, the second World African Festival of Art and Culture in Lagos, Nigeria. And so what I did was I decided to throw a party because I had no museum, I had no backing, I had no infrastructure. And so the one thing that I was very good at in graduate school was throwing parties, better than writing papers. I'm still better at that than writing. And so I decided I would get everyone together, I'd get the artists together, the musicians I've been talking to, these guys in Antibalas had just started forming this amazing Afrobeat group, this multicultural Afrobeat group in New York. Michael Veal had started writing his biography. It just happened to turn out that MCA Records was deciding at that time to release Fela's archive of music after he died in 97. So everything was converging at the right time. Complete serendipity. I had no idea those things were happening. I was just on this, you know, tunnel vision path. I threw a party, and long story short, and I'll explain why, is it was a great party. We got the very coveted Tuesday 7 o'clock slot at a place called Shine, which was very close to Shrine, which was the name of Fela's club. And at the end of the party, everybody said, when's the next one? And I thought, oh my God, I can't just keep throwing parties. But everybody was determined. I had Rich Medina as my partner, and he's an incredible DJ. And wound up, Rich said, yeah, I want to keep doing this, because he was only able to sort of slip in Fela Afrobeat tracks into hip-hop sets periodically here and there and keep people moving on the dance floor. But if I could do an entire Afrobeat set, that'd be amazing. So we started doing that, and before I knew it, I was running a monthly club night in New York, accidentally, totally by accident. But what happened was, this is 2 years in advance to the show actually finally being accepted by the New Museum. And when it opened in 2003 in that summer, everyone who came to that club night called Jumpin' Funk came to the opening without an invitation. It was the VIP preview. But everybody, was their show, because they'd been dancing to it. I was screening bootleg documentary stuff on Fela. I was selling t-shirts. I was passing out literature about the show. I was trying to sell this idea. So everybody there believed that, and rightfully so, that they were part of this project. And they all bum-rushed the opening. New Museum opened the doors, and it was this massive party, and it was fantastic. That was a lesson for me in community building. I'll just show you some of the images. That's Barclay's portrait of Fela in the back. Early Odili Donald Odita, when he was doing more conceptual work and sculptural work. He also, this is the time right at this moment where he started painting the works that you're accustomed to seeing now. We can go forward. And just a close-up of this amazing portrait. Now, the other thing I want to just point out about Barclay is that he had never in his life painted a commission and never had painted anything anything someone else had suggested to him. And I didn't suggest he paint Fela's portrait. I just said, I'm doing this show, and he said, I'm all in. So before the New Museum signed on, Barclay painted this incredible portrait. What a gesture of friendship and dedication, but more so than anything, his love of Fela. I'll keep moving, because I've got a lot of images I just want to talk to you about. Just a different, so you can see Odili Adito on the right, Lemmy Gariakwu on the back, and Billy Bijaka up top. Satch Hoyt, an artist, very under-recognized artist who I worked with a lot over the years. His capsule here dedicated to Fela's wives on the left, Watara on the right. And of course, Sanaa Mukujeto created this amazing piece which was riffing on Adrian Piper, of course, now has this wonderful show at MoMA, and her funk lessons piece. So she updated it to be Afro-funk lessons, and she brought in her plant. There is Yemisi, dancing on the right, who is Fela's cousin. And so she was working with Fela's family, and they're dancing to Afrobeat and sort of, you know, teaching white folks in Switzerland how to dance to Afrobeat. The dialectic of jubilation. And your nyash is your ass. That's your, shake your ass. And so the other thing, you know, as being inspired by music, I started incorporating music into shows right off the bat. And so I worked with a friend, a music critic and writer, Peter Orlov, and he and I compose this 100-track sort of timeline of music that inspired Fela, Fela's music, and then those who've come after him. This was up until 2003. And then, of course, had this sort of wall of imagery of photographs and albums and things that I collected over the years. But at this time in 2018, it doesn't seem like a big deal. In 2003, I can't tell you how many conversations I had about, is it really the right place in an art museum and in even a show about a musician? It was really confounding to people, especially an African musician that they had not heard of. So we've come such a long way in 15 years that these things have been challenged by so many people. Franklin Sermons, shortly before this, had curated a show around hip-hop. And lucky that we had sort of become friends at that time and started collaborating a little bit. But for me, it was complete naivete. I hadn't made a study of curatorial practice. You know, I wasn't trying to rock the boat. I was just trying to do something that I had not seen and something that inspired me. And everything that I try to do, I want to bring a human touch to it. You know, it's not really talked about very much when people talk about curatorial practice, but I want there to be a warmth and openness to everything that I do. Just to mention Franklin and his wonderful show, The World Game, on at PAM right now, we first co-organized a show called The Beautiful Game in 2006, and then Franklin has now done two other iterations of that, updating it and expanding it and improving upon it. So for me, every show is a way to engage a broader audience. I love art history. I studied art history, both in college and undergrad and grad school. But I'm not so interested in the art-on-art conversation. I'm really interested in how art engages with the general public, how it engages with popular culture, how it engages with politics. And so there's always some hook. There's always some angle that the average person, hopefully, can find a way in and turn more people on to contemporary art. So this was the first show after I left. I was an independent curator in New York in the previous shows. In the Nasher Museum, where I am now, opened in 2005, in the fall of 2005, and in the spring of 06, summer of 06, I was hired as their first contemporary art curator. And I think I had 9 months and a tiny budget to pull together a first show, because as you can imagine, when a museum first opens, all of the money and all the ideas go into the bricks and mortar. Let's get the museum open. But there were no shows really on the schedule. So our director at that time, Kim Rorschach, said, you know, what do you have? What ideas do you have? And I said, well, I've been thinking about some of these artists, and I sort of came up with, you know, Mark Bradford, William Cordova, who has a great show opening tomorrow, and Robin Rhoda from South Africa. And it really was a way to get something off the ground quickly, but also show that this engagement with street life and engagement with this idea of accumulation and removal of information that they both engage with. Sorry, if you go to the next image, please. Just to show you, everybody knows Mark Bradford's work, but this is as early as 2005. So the show opened in spring 2007. Mark at this time was just starting to take off, and Dennis and Deborah Shaw, we borrowed work from them, very graciously lent to this show, as did many others. And for me, it was a real moment to sort of have some time. Mark is someone who I'd met in at the freestyle show that Thelma Golden curated at the Studio Museum in Harlem, and both my wife Tika Selman and I wrote for that catalog at the time, and we sort of hit it off then. I was thinking, well, what could I do with this guy? You know, he looks like, I knew he was very smart and really talented. I had no idea he was going to become the artist he is today. And William is an artist I worked with now multiple times. And I really, I enjoy that process of like Barclay, like Wageshi, who I'll talk about. But William is someone who, in this capacity, this was like, is a three-person show, but the scale of it was almost like having three small solo shows in one. And getting to go in depth. So this is the type of thing as an independent curator you don't really get to do very much. It usually was a thematic show. So it was a way to engage and go really a little bit more deeply with individual artists. But William I've worked with again and again on the record and these other shows that I'll show you, Southern Accent, and also one other collection show. So back to Barclay. And I almost organized this whole show around Barclay because this is the 1 year anniversary. For those of you who don't know, he passed away last year around this time. And it's only been a year, and so much has happened. Over the 18 years that almost that we knew one another, we'd worked together on numerous occasions, and we became very, very close friends. So it was a big loss. But this was part of this, you know, my experience was him saying, come on out, I'll show you what we got, you know, let me show you the works. And it was just mind-blowing to me that these works were A, still in his home, B, available for me to show, just in whatever I was doing. And then C, I said, you know, let's organize a big show. Let's do a big show of your work. You have so much of it. We're going to dig, and we can find so much of it was sold into private collections and a handful of museums. I said, let's do it, you know. And he said, Trevor, I'd love to do it. We're going to do it. You know, I loved working with you on Fella. I love the Magic City. And I said, you know, but Barclay, the one thing you probably don't understand is that the people who do know your work adore it, and they know how impactful it is and how revolutionary the work was at the time when you first created. Because these paintings that we were showing were primarily from 68 to 82, these life-size portraits. And I said, plus there's a whole generation of younger artists that are deeply inspired by you who've only gotten to see two, maybe three paintings at the most, four if they actually got to see Black Male in person. And he said, that's great. We'll put on a great show. I'll believe all that other shit when I see it. Typical Barclay. So we organized Birth of the Cool, and we just reissued the catalog, came out in hardcover now, and added some information in the back after Barclay passed. This was in 2008. And it opened at the Nasher Museum, and it traveled to the Studio Museum in Harlem and the Santa Monica Museum in Los Angeles, the Contemporary Arts Museum Houston, and also Barclay's alma mater, the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts in Philadelphia. I don't want to linger too much, because I have a lot to show. What I'd done last night is I totally changed my PowerPoint to include more images, so I could just talk to you about themes and instead of lingering on works and talking about specific artists. But Barclay's played such a big role in my career that I wanted to spend a little extra time here. Three different self-portraits, just giving you a sense of, if you look at this and then look at the next image, see Barclay is a young man on the right, 67 at his Academy show when he was graduating, getting his certificate from PAFA. And on the left, it looks so dark here, but we had sort of almost recreated part of that installation as the show traveled. As it made its way around, it was a way, what essentially happened is people got their first introduction to his work. And not just the public and not just curators and collectors, but young artists, maybe more than anything, is I think the biggest impact that we're gonna feel and we're seeing today. So many young artists are inspired by his work. This is the back of the catalog, and also just Barclay, first and foremost, he almost started as a photographer in a way. He got a travel scholarship from the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts in 67 and 68, first African-American student there to get it 2 years in a row to go to Europe, in North Africa, and travel all around, see all the old masterworks, which inspired him. But he bought his first camera for that trip. And if any of you have met him over the years, he never took it off his shoulder after that. Like anything he did a public interview, he had the camera on his shoulder. Someone said, can I get that camera for you? He said, no. And he was always with them. But he was so far ahead of the curve, it's just hard to explain. Just to give you a sense, and I'll zip through these. If you see this work in person, or some of you have seen it, and you look at those shoes, those are the canvas shoes with the rubber toe, the denim jacket, the visor that's that clear, translucent plastic. All of these things look exactly as they are. They read as those materials. But at the same time, he does things that aren't hyper-realistic. And he does things that in painting classes they tell you not to do, like cut off the head, you know, cut off the toe. But he wanted the character to come out into our space to engage with us. And more than that, Barclay captured the soul, the character, and the identity of his subjects. He had a very empathetic relationship with them. You can feel that when you look at the work. And that's what makes him so masterful. The work I referred to, this is the first work I saw in person at the Studio Museum in Harlem. William Corbett, North Philly, where Barclay grew up. When Barclay went to the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts, his friend here went to the state penitentiary. Sweet Thing, which is just, I'm not allowed to say, but just going into a wonderful collection, public collection, we'll all get to see it. And I'm including a couple of works that are in our collection, because one of the things I want to point out is that with each of these shows, we've been buying works. These shows that have been traveling nationally and building a collection that looks a little bit unlike others, in part because there was no contemporary art collection at the Nasher Museum. There are very few pieces in the holdings. Got Questlove down to spin the opening. Again, the engagement with music and community, way to bring people together. I think of curating as a way to bring people together. And also curating as a creative force, as a creative act, just like making artwork or making music, is an act, is to me inherently a hopeful act. It's hopeful that someone will pay attention. It's hopeful that you might be able to change something to make some, bring some good. So embracing that love of music, my first job out of college was, I didn't have any career path laid out. I worked in a record store making minimum wage. My mother wondered what I was doing, and I loved it. And I only left because I got accepted to graduate school and got a scholarship to go. And if I hadn't gotten the scholarship, I probably wouldn't have gone either. But luckily I did, and I'm here in front of you now. But, you know, this, again, William Cordova was in this show. That's a work by a Dutch artist on the front, where the beak of the bird, his father's a taxidermist in Holland, and the beak of the bird actually plays the records. So, as you may be able to tell, I'm interested in what other people are not looking at. And Jeroen Diepenmaat has no exposure in the United States. I don't think he's going to go down the annals as one of the great artists, but I think this work is brilliant, and it's whimsical, and it's clever, and it's smart, and I think there's a real place for that. Christian Marclay, who is one of the foundational artists of this show, all of his work has been around the visualization of music and sound, and so much work with records. And then, of course, bringing in artists who people don't expect at all, lesser-known works. And this wonderful Carrie Mae Weems work, which we then bought for the collection, live at the Copa, Dee Dee. The title is Ode to Affirmative Action. So if you know Carrie Mae's work, that's very appropriate. And, of course, that's she herself there singing, as if she's her record's gone gold, Clarksdale, Mississippi Records. And I've referenced William before. But bringing in these artists, bringing in works that, my background is contemporary African, but always trying to cut across that and find ways where you can work with artists from different backgrounds. In this case, Tayo Kimura, artist from Japan who I met on a couple trips there and gotten to work with. Brilliant, hilarious, dark humor. As the record spin, it constricts on his neck and pulled his head down closer. A wonderful video. He had also work in Prospect New Orleans, this past iteration, Prospect 4. So trying to take a global approach, and Robin Road also, which is another work in the Nasher collection, this idea of blending performance and photography and drawing all into one, which he's so very adept at. But the idea of the show was, clearly not a look at record covers and that sort of thing, but the idea that records themselves, that they have inspired artists, the role that they have played in the contemporary art world from, say, 65 to 2010. Now, Wageshi was in that first show, The Magic City, that I showed you an image of, and then again, kind of like Barclay, I said, well, amazingly, in New York, no one had organized her sort of mid-career survey. She never had that big solo museum show. So I said, why don't we do it in Durham, and then we can travel it? She said, great. We'd become very good friends over the years and very easy to work with. She created site-specific work. She came down. This was also right after she had just delivered her child, her second child, and it was remarkable that just a couple weeks after that, she was down here creating this work on scaffolding. Incredibly dedicated, brilliant artist. Wagashi she moved to a fantastic journey. On the left is a work called Family Tree, which we'll see another work of, another image of, and there Wagashi actually producing this work. And the idea of, you know, bringing an artist to make new works on site, collecting those works for the institution has become a strategy. When a museum opens, where do you start with contemporary art? You could do anything. So we started building out of our collections. And then the types of shows that we were organizing, it gave us some direction. And so we really were unable to follow the market because we didn't have deep pockets. But it also gave us an opportunity. It freed us up in a lot of ways to do things that are more experimental and support artists who had not had a great deal of attention. Of course, at this time, by the time the show opened, Wagashi was already blowing up. Show traveled to the Brooklyn Museum, traveled to the Block in Northwestern, and then, of course, it traveled here to North Miami when the museum was still operative. The one thing that people don't think about too much with Wagashi is that she's, and the things that we connected on are our mutual loves of music and environmentalism. And with Wagashi, you definitely think about her interest in feminism, her interest in the African diaspora, and even sort of a type of futurism, the way that she creates her own mythologies. But environmentalism is always at the heart of her work. And just going forward to that pink work, where this is a work that she actually created for the Black President show, a new work that she created at that time, which was in homage to Fela's mother, Funmi Layo, who's a leader of the women's movement in Nigeria in the early 70s. And going forward one more, where we commissioned a video and helped her produce it, The End of Eating Everything. And this was sort of her environmental, amazing animated, her first time moving into animation. And that idea of supporting someone at a time when they're trying to do something new and break new ground in their own practice is what's incredibly exciting to me, and I think for many curators. But it's risk-taking. It requires a lot of, you know, she's someone who I had a very close relationship with and I've known for some time. There you can see on the far right, this is the installation when it traveled to the Brooklyn Museum, and it was the head of Santigold. Moving ahead to Southern Accent, this was a show I organized in 2016. And so it wasn't so long ago, but a show that I co-curated with Miranda Lash, who was the curator of contemporary art at the New Orleans Museum of Art, and then now is the curator of contemporary and modern at the Speed Art Museum in Louisville, Kentucky. And it was an investigation of what it means to be Southern. So not a survey of the landscape of Southern artists or but more so an idea of trying to complicate the notion of Southernness, if that makes sense. And if you think about what it means to be Southern, I'm born and raised in North Carolina. I was gone for 12 years and had the opportunity to come back to North Carolina to Duke University. But what you see in Hollywood, what you see in the news, is always this fairly one-dimensional stereotypical imagery, in part because there's truth to it. But also, it's so much more multidimensional, multifaceted, and complex than that. And there's so many different sides to the cube. So that was our goal, to sort of complicate this story, but secondarily to say the South has actually made great contributions to the art world, and those are almost never discussed. The contributions of the South, there wouldn't be American music were it not for the South. American music, and in fact, modern music, vastly as we know it, in terms of soul, rock, and so on and so forth, all came out of the Southeast. So that export is very well known internationally. Food, very well known internationally. And both of these are deeply indebted to African culture. But visual arts, who knows? You know, because there were no opportunities in the South, and there haven't been for so many years. Now it's starting to change, because all the artists felt like they didn't have support systems, so they left and went to New York, or they went abroad, or they went to Chicago or L.A., and then they were never discussed as Southerners anymore. For that matter, Jasper Johns and Rauschenberg hardly even discussed as Southerners. But it deeply influenced their work. So this is a couple of installation shots. That's good. We can keep moving. Just want to show the massive show, 60 artists and about 9,000 square feet. But you can see not all the artists are from the South. A lot of artists have been coming to the South, inspired by it, investigating deeply, trying to make connections not only from the American South, but to the global South. And a lot of what is at the forefront of Southern studies in academia now, we were trying to also address in this exhibition. So in the front is Theaster Gates, Soul Food Rickshaw for Collard Greens and Whiskey. In the back is, you know, in the rickshaw, of course, not being an American invention. And in the back, Ebony G. Patterson, and being a Jamaican artist living and working in Kentucky. And it's, if you look at it closely, and with so much of her work, it's this brilliant, sparkling, dazzling work, but there's a dark side to it, and there's these legs hanging, so it's Strange Fruit is the title. So Radcliffe Bailey, Barclay Hendricks. And of course, for this show, also made a large playlist and music library, as we called it, with two other colleagues that really helped me tremendously. Because as a counterpoint to the visual, it really helped bring life to it, actually understanding a lot of what these visuals were responding to is the music. That people first think of the South. When I think of an exhibition and I'm curating a show, as you've already found out, I'm not the most articulate person in the world. So I have a hard time getting it on paper. It takes me a while. Thankfully, I've had directors that are very patient with me and believe in the process. But the first thing I actually do is I can see it, I can see the visuals, and I can hear it. And I hear a soundscape, and I hear music, which informs exactly the direction I'm going to go in. James Herbert and REM, they made this beautiful video. James Herbert did with Michael Stipe and REM, because those guys were, of course, from Athens, Georgia, and were students at UGA. And James Herbert was Michael Stipe's art professor. He was an experimental filmmaker. This is at the beginning of MTV, which was just a couple years earlier. So at this time, there were no great videos, period. It was all experimental. But James Herbert took it to another level, because he had no idea how to make a music video. So instead of creating one track for this amazing album, Reckoning, by REM, he created a 20-minute experimental shot with them running through this this site-specific folk art, landscape, with the band members moving through and engaging with this artist. And it's this grainy footage, and I should have shown you a clip, but including that in the show was really meaningful, because it create this marriage of landscape, a sense of place, and then the way that music and visual help inform it, and also marrying experimental film with outsider art at the same time. So it sort of did everything in one package. But it was never released, because you can't run a 20-minute video on MTV, but especially when MTV actually played videos, which were 3 minutes long. And so it was never released, and you know, so they called it Left of Reckoning. It was basically synced to half of the album. The first half, so we can go to the next. Xyveria Simmons made beautiful work for this show, and you guys know her work well here. Shows with David Castillo, and I've worked with her on numerous occasions. She's someone who I love working with. I love the way that ideas come to her, and the way that she thinks so far outside the box. And again, just complicating this notion, Native American artists, artists from the Bronx on the far right, self-taught and created in 64, but a response to the JFK assassination, and also not trying to define what the South is, but rather expand that notion. And on the far left is a work by Sonia Clark. And if you go to the next image, it's called Unraveling. And some of you may have seen this on the internet or maybe even experienced it in person, but it was an unbelievably timely, brilliant work that she had created before the huge controversy around the Confederate flag. And with Bree Newsom scaling the flagpole in Charleston, South Carolina, and taking it down by force. And she created this in advance, but what she's doing is not shredding it, but meticulously taking apart the flag, thread by thread by thread. And she invites audience participation, people to come up with her and do it. That's actually my mother, but she was one of like 50 people that day. And it shows what a complicated conversation it is. You know, it's such a wonderful metaphor for the way that these images work and how hard it is to just easily and quickly dismantle them. Yes, we can take it down, but it doesn't necessarily change the fabric of society overnight. Of course, you have to have William Eggleston. But then bringing in artists who are lesser known, and this is someone who I learned about through Franklin Sermon's Prospect 3 in New Orleans. Douglas Bourgeois, an artist based in Louisiana, who's revered there and really not known anywhere outside of Louisiana, but a brilliant artist. And that's a painting of, Irma Thomas, a soul queen in New Orleans. But what he captured with the lush vegetation, which of course you can relate to here, a slightly different landscape in New Orleans than South Florida, but this sense of overgrowth, the idea that, you know, this was painted just after Katrina, and you can feel this idea of exodus, and also the suitcases, the refrigerator out, and these types of things you can see throughout the South on a front porch. The old appliances, there's nowhere to put them, just leave them out on the front porch. Robert Colescott is starting to get some of the attention he really deserves now. And then bringing in artists who are lesser known, Deborah Grant, the wonderful artist who worked with in the past, based in New York. The work inspired by Katrina, but of course using the imagery of Bill Traylor, a self-taught artist from Alabama, and using his iconography and his imaging. And bringing in artists who've had, who've been sort of fallen off the radar. Jim Roche, some of you may know, he's a Floridian, but from North Florida. And he had a real moment in the 70s, showing at the Whitney, showed at Paula Cooper, and then sort of left New York, went back to Florida, and started teaching and making work. But this work from 73, 74 is amazing. This environmental work, performance, drawing, conceptual art, just the way that he encapsulates all these different worlds. He's done sound work, fantastic artist, and just really, really under-recognized, but trying to bring these gems in and give them another opportunity to be seen. We've acquired this work for the museum also. Dario Robledo is someone I worked with many times, and you'll see that when I find someone I love their practice and they are not already a superstar, I continue to go back to them. And it's that way we grow together and we can try new things together. A defeated soldier wishes to walk his daughter down the wedding aisle. I don't have the time to talk in depth about Dario because he's such an amazing, complicated artist. But everything you see there is an illusion. So those are not boots and prosthetics, but they are molded from Civil War prosthetics, from World War I boots, and molded out of things like cast from vinyl records, and because alchemy is really at the heart of Dario's work. So songs like that he has specifically cut out of a record like Soldier Boy by the Shirelles and giving it a different life. And the idea that this soldier who had lost his legs, the only thing he wanted to do was walk his daughter down the wedding aisle. One of the things that Dara and I talk about a lot is this idea of emotional content that really gets left out of the conversation because he's such a heady, brilliant conceptual artist. But there is this emotional content and warmth to everything that he produces. Kara Walker, of course, but trying to bring in something new, very early work that had been in her studio and no one had seen in RISD and storage since 94. And then keeping up with commissioning new work, Hank Willis Thomas. And this, if you've seen his recent show, his current show at Jack Shaman, this is where that body of work began with the work that he made for this exhibition. And again, supporting him in a new endeavor is part of what we really love to do. And these are images taken in the 60s in Selma and by this photographer, Spider Martin, that, and without going into the whole background, but Hank got the opportunity to work with that archive of documentary photographs and then transform them through these mirrored images. And Hank does a lot of appropriation in his work and transformation, but what was so beautiful here is you can see yourself in the images. And I took it at an angle so you could actually see the work. But when you see yourself in it, it's placing us in these protests and these civil rights marches in the 60s and saying, you know, at this moment in time, we haven't actually come that far. We're still very much connected to that moment in history. And the work was incredibly moving for, this was a really cathartic show for being shown in the South. It didn't stir problems, but it asked people to really think about their own perceptions and their own way of living. Thornton Dial, brilliant artist, he passed a few years back. Mel Chin, an artist based in North Carolina, from deeper south, but again embracing this idea of the ready found object assemblage, which you see in so much outsider art. Minnie Evans, lesser known North Carolinian, visionary artist, 1963. Self-taught, self-made. And this is just a smattering. There's 60 artists in the show, so just trying to give you an idea of the breadth. And then also trying to speak to the present. This is an incredibly young artist, Diego Camponseco, who at the time had just graduated with his BA from the UNC Chapel Hill. And first generation, born in Burgaw, North Carolina, tiny little farming town in eastern North Carolina. His family immigrated from Mexico and are field laborers, and he is responding to that, and he had fantastic work. Very difficult for us to find artists that were addressing that, the new migration, the new South, and the changing physical landscape, who were not outsiders looking in. We really didn't want to take that approach. So many amazing documentary photographers have done great work there, but we really wanted the practitioner to be speaking from their own point of view. And then all this is sort of a build up to Prospect. And Prospect New Orleans is a triennial. This is the fourth iteration. It takes place in New Orleans every 3 years. It's a little redundant for me to say. The Lotus in Spite of the Swamp was the title for me. A title I came up with about 2 years before the show opened and turned out to be a little prophetic as we got deeper into the mire that we're in now. just as a title, but I wanted to take a sort of hopeful approach because all we're still being bombarded with is bad information, bad news. And that's the world we live in. Some of the critics of the show pointed out that they wanted to see more political work, but as we go through, every work in the show is deeply political. So I didn't quite understand that. I think what they meant to say is confrontational. And that's not really an approach that I take in the way that I think and the way that I work. And I prefer much more nuanced work that has a subtle approach. And some of the works are confrontational, but most of them are not. Most of them you really have to spend time with, and they're addressing all the same issues, but they're not trying to push you away. And that's something I learned from Fela Kuti himself, who is incredibly outspoken. But he said, you know, he had this unbelievably seductive music. It is, you cannot not move if you hear Afrobeat. It's impossible not to shake. It's impossible not to dance. the most beautiful go-go dancers and his queens that danced with him on stage. He knew how to seduce you. But once he got you here in this space, he would lecture to you about politics for half an hour or more before the concert would start. And he knew that he had to pull you in. And so that sense of beauty, that sense of seduction, and pulling you in with that nuance. So this work's been much talked about, so I don't have to go into great detail, but the Kadaswaf caravan that Care Walker produced was, you know, one of the cornerstones of the show. And I don't say that lightly, because I think that there, in my opinion, all the artists produce brilliant work. And I don't know that this is any more brilliant than any of the other works. But what it is more impactful. And partly because of who Kara is, but also because that she did something and attempted something that she'd never done before, never even thought of. When we came to New Orleans, part of our process was to bring artists in and take them around the city and go to different places, historic sites, and give them the lay of the land, introduce them to people, and to help inspire them. And then we only did this with maybe a quarter or less, maybe a fifth of the artists. So it wasn't a huge number, because there's not budget to go beyond that. But Kara is one of the first artists I reached out to. And bringing her in, we took the ferry from essentially the French Quarter over the Mississippi to Algiers, which is the West Bank. And there is the point where when during slavery, when ships would come in, that's where they would quarantine slaves to see that they were well enough to bring them into the slave markets for auction in New Orleans proper in the French Quarter and beyond. And so when we were talking about this history and walking around, there was this, I should have shown an image, this pathetic tiny little plaque that, I don't know if commemorates is not the right word, but gives notice to that history, that dark history. And she, of course, I could see she was struck by that. That's all there is. And it is the way that New Orleans has dealt with most of their historical markers. But it is deeply insufficient. So she started thinking about that, and at the same time, there's a tourist attraction called the Natchez Steamboat that goes up and down the Mississippi. And on that boat is, you may be familiar with the calliope. It's like a steam organ. And so it's playing Dixieland music and at times Dixie itself. And so she's hearing that, which she's listening to while thinking about this history of Africans coming to the New World and being unloaded and quarantined in this space and hearing Dixie. And the conflict between those two realities is what led to this work. So she went out and went deep down the rabbit hole before even she knew where she was going. So the first thing she thought of is, I wanted to create a sonic response. She hadn't even thought about the visuals or the physical structure. But I want to actually create a sonic response to the Natchez Dixie. And I'm going to create songs of liberation and black resistance. And I was like, brilliant. Great. I love it. That's a fantastic idea. And the whole thing was sort of this whole, you know, to make a joke, but Made in America project. So everything, she went and found a gentleman in Michigan who still made custom calliopes. And she started going out there and working with him, making a calliope. Then went to, when she's finally figured out the sort of form she wanted to take, this sort of carnival caravan. And the wagon wheels here, these classic old Americana wheels, are just like exactly the type of wheels that were put on caravans to travel out west. So she sourced everything, and she created this amazing work. But it was more than we could manage for the opening, and more than in many ways. And so this was unveiled at the closing ceremony. And what you're seeing here is there was this torrential downpour. So I forgot to say, she was working with Jason Moran, the jazz pianist and artist. And they together had created this beautiful soundscape. But he was also performing it live twice that weekend on a keyboard. And you can't play that long. You can only play about 15 minutes on this before you have to let it rest and sort of reboot. So he's performing, and just as he is going, just buckets of rain. Just everybody had umbrellas out and just pouring. The second he stopped, the skies opened, the sun came out, and this giant rainbow that touched down on the other side came out. And it was like this amazing cleansing. It's like she had done something around that work, around that very specific history on that site, and then the site specificity of that work was deeply important. There, we can go to the next. Had the pleasure of working with Yoko Ono's studio. Have You Seen the Horizon Lately? Is a work that, a conceptual text work that she produced in 66 as a very small work originally on a note card, and then it became a billboard project later, but it also is a song, the title of her song on Approximately Infinite Universe from the early 70s, beautiful song. So from the, you know, from some Kara Walker, like this, you know, hard-hitting work to the sublime in Yoko, and that kind of sums up the range of work. And I did want to really point out Barclay Hendricks, because after Barclay passed, we were working together on him trying to produce new work for Prospect. And of course, he passed away, and so that work was never realized. And so what we did is I really wanted to make it something more impactful even than we had envisioned and discussed. And went as hard as I could digging to get works that had not been included in our Birth of the Cool. And so there's only, out of 12 large portraits, only one was in Birth of the Cool. And the others were largely coming from private collections, and then also in his resuscitated, not career, but his resuscitated practice of painting portraits after Fella. That was the first one he had painted since 82 till 2003. And then he had two great shows with Seamus. So he showed a little bit of work from bookended from 1970 to 2016. So again, the new work and then older work that we had, you know, self-portrait that we had uncovered. Nama Sabar, amazing performance that she produced. Some of you may have seen in Art Basel 2 years ago, the performance she did with, I'm forgetting the organizing body, but I first saw that here. I knew her sculptural work and her performative work, but I hadn't seen these large compositions, and so I said I want to do a new one, and it was magnificent. And then there's the importance of actually engaging with New Orleans itself. So in thinking about the thematic, the lotus in spite of the swamp, it's a basic concept is simply that in arduous times and in difficult times, the ability to rise above those circumstances, because the beautiful lotus flower comes from this fetid, noisome muck, and this graceful flower grows out. So it's a metaphor, not so much to speak literally to the landscape of New Orleans, but of what is happening internationally and globally and how we can all learn from that metaphor. But the Mardi Gras Indians, or the black masking Indians, as Daryl refers to them, are a great example of that. Because so what I did in my, this is a just crummy photo because I took it on my iPhone, but I went and spent, these guys, for those who don't know, this is part of Mardi Gras, but it's the unsanctioned ceremonies. It's the off-the-beaten-track. These are essentially family-driven social clubs that are almost like small secret societies. And every year they mask, or they create new suits, these incredibly elaborate suits that Nick Cave has been inspired by. And they come out, and there's no parade route. So while everybody else is partying and catching beads and doing all that, these guys come out at some point during the day and follow some route somewhere. And that's about all you know. So the only thing you know is that they're uptown Indians and they're downtown Indians. And that Daryl's going to come out. His father was, Daryl Montana is the big chief of his tribe, Yellow Pocahontas. And so I went out, instead of doing the conventional stuff on Mardi Gras, I went out early that morning to wait for Daryl Montana to come out. It was the last year, 40, almost 50 years he's been masking since he was a teenager. And this is going to be his last year. That's the last suit he made. So we showed a lot of these suits in an installation, but I wanted to be there to experience it because they're meant to be performed. They're not simply meant to be revered as objects. To see it live and the way that it transforms. So I waited and waited and nothing was happening. You know, I was there 8, 9, 10, 11. Went to get some lunch, stopped by Zulu for a while, hung out there, came back, still going, sundown. You can tell it's dark. Daryl comes out. And it was so typical, like this, such an esoteric practice, like the, intentionally not trying to let the general public in. Now, I had spent a lot of time with him and his wife, Sabrina, in the next image. And so there's another picture I took of another member of his tribe, and then a photograph of one of the works inside, so you can see some of the range of the practice. But, you know, I'd spent a lot of time with him, but there's no way of explaining what it's like to be there in that moment when they come out. In two tribes, it's like it's very analogous to early days of hip-hop when two gangs would compete with one another. And sort of like a, you know, they used to fight to say, like, his father was the one who changed the competition between tribes, between who was the toughest and the strongest and the meanest to who was the prettiest and who was the most artful and the most artistic. And so it's a beautiful practice, and you know, now he's starting to get recognized in the art world a little bit, which is wonderful. I'm not the first to show his work. But thinking about that and other artists bringing them in, artists like Rina Banerjee, who has no relationship to New Orleans, and but her work speaks so beautifully to Mardi Gras, speaks to the Mardi Gras Indians, to Carnival, her sense of materials. And she actually did come in, we brought her in, and she did respond specifically to New Orleans. In researching the South Asian migration to the United States and how so many people from South Asia, in India in particular, when they came to the U.S., where they found community was in African-American neighborhoods and started intermarrying. And she actually specifically delved into a very one history in New Orleans and named the work after this. Maria Barrio. You know, you can tell that I'm very interested in the global South, interested in the way that you can bring in artists who are lesser known and have them have a huge impact. This is a big coming out party for Maria Barrio. It's a wonderful artist. This is about the scale of the work, actually, believe it or not, and it's all collage. I mean, a little bit of drawing with charcoal and but in watercolor, but it's almost all collage, and it's almost all of her work is about migration. She's from Colombia and lives in New York, and you can sort of see these references to migration and this spiritual present, the relationship between humans and nature. And then I don't know if Genevieve is here tonight, but another wonderful work for me and being able to work with her, having not ever worked with her, really known her before, and calling her up and asking if she might be interested in this opportunity. You know, with Prospect, there's no, it's a show, I should say, there are 73 artists, 17 different venues, and none of it is predetermined before you get there. So you have to find venues, you have to negotiate everything. And I thought, well, the Ace Hotel had just opened. I was trying to think of places where the average person would be inside and not just those who would go to museums. There's certain works like obviously paintings that have to be in museums with all of the humidity and light controls and security. But in this case, I thought hopefully if they're glazed works, you know, the glass over the frame, we could protect them. There were some issues here and there because of the way that Genevieve treats a space as an installation. Everything you're looking at here, the wallpaper, the furniture, the photographs, everything is her vision. The Ace Hotel very graciously, it was the only way we were going to do it, was to allow her to completely transform the space. And that is she in the middle, for those of you who don't know her. And then the next image, there we go. And she on the right, front line, nothing to hide. And I think I probably need to speed things up, but Genevieve is someone who I didn't realize had roots in New Orleans, and so many of these things came out, and artists really found ways to connect with the city, not just its history and its culture, but the people of the city, and Genevieve did such a brilliant job of that. having a little bit of an insider track. Satch Hoyt, who I mentioned earlier in the Black President Show, we worked together numerous times. He did a great performance on closing weekend. What I meant to say with Kara is that, you know, it wasn't the only major project that weekend. It's just when you have an artist of that caliber, it steals all the headlines, which was fantastic because it drove people to New Orleans. But Satch Hoyt had this amazing Hair Coming Cycle performance that he had done once before in Colombia, South America, and all the picks, are mic'd, and all the different types of hair. And the way you can see with Satch, he's a British-born artist of Jamaican descent, and you can hear the combing of the hair, and the hair speaking to identity. And there's Satch's album cover shot we had to take, because he started as a musician, and he moved into the visual arts. So that's like his Fela album cover. And then more performance in public work. The Kitchen Sisters and Odabanga Jones and Associates. Odabanga Jones and Associates, an artist collective based in Houston, Texas, have created this project before. What we did is transformed it, and I asked them to collaborate to do something new and add a new element. So the Kitchen Sisters are not recognized as artists. They are storytellers. They have a great, amazing NPR podcasts, and they're known in sort of the documentary world and storytelling world on radio. But they also do these great interactive live events. And I thought, well, why don't we bring them in, collaborate with, there's Jamal Cyrus sitting in the back of this pink Cadillac with huge speakers out the back in this setting, in this historically African-American neighborhood. And we had this session of interviews, performances. It was just a great Sunday afternoon. Radcliffe Bailey, I won't talk too much about it. We had works along the river. Two things I tried to do, and I think are filter into every show, is this idea of connectivity. And two of the things that really connected a lot in this, obviously this thread of cultural politics, but I would say also water and its ability to connect and think about New Orleans specifically and its relationship to the rest of the world, why it is where it is. You know, situated in the Gulf of Mexico and the mouth of the Mississippi, but also, this park is a new park that was established along the Mississippi River, first time having access to it for locals and tourists alike, but also sound and music, and the way that those two things, they permeate and, you know, they move through physical barriers, and they sort of seep everywhere, and they create connections between works. And so the sound here, there's this conch inside, and he's created this beautiful soundscape when you step inside this vessel. And if you look the other direction, Jennifer Odom, another New Orleans-based work, artist, and her work, Rising Tables, a week later after taking this, the water was up to the second table, over the second table, and a huge log came barreling down the Mississippi and wiped out two of the three tables. She's a New Orleanian. She knew that was possible, not upset. There's nothing she could do. In fact, when she created this, she was expecting, she knew the tides and when they rise, and was actually looking forward to that and seeing the evolution of it. Again, sense of environmentalism and bringing more Native artists, First Nation artists, Rebecca Belmore, speaking to their mother. I was surprised they allowed this work to be lent. I'm very grateful. And then I just want to close with John Acumfra, because the other artist who I reached out to immediately was John. And he's someone who I connected with in the early 2000s because he was creating a documentary on Fela Kuti for the BBC, which was never finished and realized, and while I was curating that show. And for years, we've been thinking about, God, what can we do together? I had a couple documentary ideas for him. I had no idea how to raise money for a documentary, so it never happened. But we talked about them incessantly. And finally, with Prospect, there was the opportunity to produce something of grand scale. So again, John came down, like many artists, like Kara and Rena and others, Barclay included, to brainstorm and think about what their work might become. And if you just move to the next image, he and his team, Smoking Dog Films, created this amazing film called Precarity, which is on view at the Nasher right now. We helped commission the work and fund it and produce it, and it's now part of the Nasher Museum collection. And as part of the wave, we've been able to acquire works on a tight budget. But what it is a look at New Orleans at the turn of the century, around 1900. And it's through the lens of the guy on the left is a portrayal of Buddy Bolden, who was said to be the founder of jazz. This moment when all these worlds collided, African drumming and call and response, European brass band traditions, and then sort of what Louis Armstrong called the Spanish tinge, the Cuban syncopation. And those things coming together and sort of creating jazz music, and that fusion, and that sense of cross-cultural fertilization and hybridity was at the heart of the show throughout. But John did such a brilliant job with his team in creating this three-channel installation. It was 45 minutes long, and it's just mesmerizing. So if any of you head north to North Carolina at any point, it's on view there until September 2nd. There, I think I will stop this ramble. And thank you very much. Thanks.